Hello, my fellow Extraordinary Americans. I'm Cosmos Dar, and this is Extraordinary America. What is Extraordinary America about? You see, American identity is about freedom, the opportunity for a better life, and the pursuit of happiness. However, most Americans are not free when it comes to the financial front. Most Americans are suffering from financial slavery due to loss of jobs, stagnant wages, inflation, and debt of all kinds. Wealth and income inequality runs rampant across America, and the middle class is all but disappeared. So what is Extraordinary America about? Extraordinary America is about the abolition of financial slavery. It is about the financial freedom of the 99%. It is about the nation of immigrants and descendants of immigrants awakening and unleashing the extraordinary within themselves and setting themselves free. The path to financial freedom is through entrepreneurship and investing on the light side. It is about financial education, not only when it comes to money in the monetary systems, but also in regards to how to start a business, investing, especially when it comes to precious metals and real estate. In this podcast, I interview guests, many of whom came from humble beginnings, to see how they did it and how they attained financial freedom in their own lives and how they did business. And it is my hope that you will be inspired and you will want to awaken extraordinary within yourselves and realize the American dream. Once again, welcome to Extraordinary America. Linda, are you there?
Hi, Cosmos. Oh my gosh, it is so good to be with you. Thank you so much for that extraordinary introduction. And thank you so much for creating this dynamic platform. We are so grateful to you.
I'm grateful to you as well for taking the time to come to this podcast and share your invaluable wisdom. So Linda, I know you're an entrepreneur and you've been in brand marketing and all of that. Can you tell me and the audience a little bit more about yourself, your background, and how you got started?
Absolutely. So early in my career, I knew that to really be able to leverage the gifts and talents that I've been given, the best path forward for me was one in advertising and marketing. So I had a major in advertising, a separate major in marketing, and a minor in psychology when I graduated, and immediately began a career working for some of the largest and most prestigious advertising agencies here in the United States, in New York and Chicago and San Francisco, Los Angeles. I was able to work with incredible leaders in developing brands, repositioning brands, launching brands. And it was a remarkable sort of ongoing masterclass in what it is to be able to impact people, to influence people, and to help people with decision-making. After my time working in advertising agencies and sort of climbing the corporate ladder there, I moved into an opportunity to develop marketing, sort of in-house marketing agencies for media companies. So I was able to work with some of the largest media companies in the United States, like Belo and Scripps and Viacom, and building their marketing practices within those media organizations. Again, I rose up through the corporate ladder, often as the only woman, the youngest woman, did a lot of work to kind of break those glass ceilings and give others an opportunity to really forge creative, resourceful careers forward after me. And then at a certain juncture, I recognized that really what creates sustainable transformational change is when leaders come together for problem solving, when leaders come together for being able to advance solutions to global problems. It takes all of us, whether we're in the nonprofit sector or the for-profit sector, whether we're part of government or higher education, it's the inclusion of all of us together, coming together to really create transformational change. So I moved into an opportunity to work with some of the most impactful networking organizations in the world that attract extraordinary leaders like YPO, like EO, like Collective 54, where we helped those leaders grow and develop solutions to some of the most daunting social issues that we're facing as a generation.
So, Linda, this is like an impressive feat that you went from the corporate world into this and you were dealing with all these leaders. So, what was the strategic vision that you had for your career over the years and how did it evolve? And what was basically the motivation that motivated you to work so hard and achieve all of this?
I would say that it's been a learning journey for me. I absolutely feel as though early in my career, when I was working for advertising agencies and marketing firms, I was able to leverage my gifts and talents. And then when I was able to create marketing disciplines within larger media companies, I really learned quite a bit about the art and science of building businesses and having direct financial management and accountability over a particular area of the company and driving results, driving revenue, driving results. And that was great learning for me. As I moved into more and more senior level positions in the media companies that I worked in, I recognized that marketing is simply a tool to impact people and to try to ensure that our audience understands the benefit that we offer as a corporation or as a business, and then to ensure that I really am holding myself accountable to key performance indicators, to key results for that business. Now, through that experience, I also came to realize and really learned that no one grows as a leader by themselves. It takes a community of people around that leader to help shape and mold and really perfect their leadership style and impact. And so, through that experience of being in a community of extraordinary leaders, I came to recognize that really what I wanted to do for the last third of my career is work in a community of extraordinary leaders around the globe to help them solve some of the most comprehensive and daunting issues that we're facing. So, in Leadership Global, I've developed this incredibly impactful community of extraordinary women around the globe, helping members accelerate their success by defining their vision, growing their leadership, expanding their influence, and leaving a lasting legacy.
So Linda, like the generation of the Millennials and the Gen Z, right? They're really into not just like social impact, like creating an impact. They're also into entrepreneurship and business. But however, like they feel like a lot of people feel like there's it's like exclusive, and they didn't. Most people don't have an understanding of social impact, entrepreneurship, and business. Like if you could elaborate more on that concept, so that our audience can understand that.
Absolutely. I think that any kind of social good that we see proliferating around the world right now is connected to a visionary passion point. So if you care about regeneration of the land, or you care about climate issues, or you care about education of girls and women, or you care about clean air and clean water, whatever that passion point is, whatever it is that drives you, that makes you recognize that I am connected to an issue or a problem or a series of solutions that are bigger than I am, and I get to advance impact in a really positive way against this issue that I feel so connected to, that is social entrepreneurship. Social entrepreneurship is all about recognizing your passion, your vision, your mission connected to some sort of regional, national, or global issue that people are struggling with. And what we do at Leadership Global is we try to harness the knowledge, the influence, and the trust of high-performing and high-integrity women around the world to stimulate that kind of idea exchange, to support creativity, and to provide the resources and tools to accelerate personal and professional growth. But really, social entrepreneurship is all about leaving the world better than you found it and following your passion, following those things that mean the most to you, and providing solutions, providing innovations that will really dramatically and positively impact that issue or problem.
So, Linda, like the concept of social impact of entrepreneurship cannot be stressed enough because, like money talks, right? And at the end of the day, a lot of people want to do good, but they want to do in a way that they can actually sustain themselves. And there's always a concept that profit is a neg is like it has a negative mind concept to a lot of people, but you need to have profits in order to do greater impact. Like when you have money, you can actually create a bigger impact and you have more resources. But a lot of people seem to think that it's exclusive, that in order to make an impact, like in order to do good, you have to be live like a kind of like a Spartan lifestyle. But like, what are your thoughts on the intersection of making profits and also doing like collective good?
So think about this. What I always encourage social entrepreneurs to really think about is what is the level of impact that you can have in the world if you have $10 or you have $10 million? There's a stark difference in the level of impact that you can have once you're able to understand how to attract revenue, how to manage that revenue, how to have very sharp financial management skills, and to be able to reallocate that revenue in a way that further advances your mission, your vision. I also believe that throughout your leadership journey, you have to continue to learn how to better serve others and genuinely support their advancement and their overall engagement in your mission and vision. And the best way to attract extraordinary leaders to your mission and vision is to ensure that they are well compensated for their efforts. You have to become mindful of the opportunity and the responsibility that you have to serve your own advancement and your mission's advancement by serving others. And one of the best ways that you can serve others is to ensure that you're able to employ as many people as possible and offering them a better than average lifestyle by ensuring that you're giving them opportunities to not only make an impact, but opportunities to develop their own wealth. So, as a leader, you have a responsibility to not only generate revenue so that you can advance your mission and vision, but you have a responsibility to advance revenue so that you can responsibly take care of those around you who have joined you on your journey to create impact. And I really believe that for those people that feel like that is daunting or that's an exclusive group or club to belong to, I would invite you to develop the skills like financial management, like negotiation, like public speaking, that will help you advance your personal and professional goals. With every single step you take, you're going to identify new ways of not just mastering the fundamentals, but being creative and resourceful, which in turn provides you with greater clarity and greater depth of thought to further improve your leadership approach and to further advance your mission and your vision.
So Linda, like I completely agree with all this. Like this is like a new form of way of doing things. But for decades before this, in our traditional education system, especially in colleges and university campuses, that this is not really taught. So this form of education where you can get these tools of financial management and all that stuff, like people are now looking at the internet, they're going to YouTube and they're starting to look at all of this, but they've been taught a certain way by society. And now in this trans like during this transitional period, what are your thoughts? Like, what would be your advice to somebody on how to get the educational resources to start on this journey if they have like a vision they want to see succeed?
Yeah, I have to tell you that there are more resources now than there ever have been to help anyone who's interested on embarking on a continuous journey of discovery and learning. And I would say that the most dynamic and the most impressive leaders that I've ever met in my career are lifetime learners. And it's by seeking out those resources and tools that will help inform your perspective and nurture new skills and aptitudes that allow you to take that next step in not just revenue generation, but advancing your mission and vision. At every single stage of your career, I think every dynamic leader needs to learn how to create sustainable impact and influence by being a lifetime learner. And as I said, there's never been a better time to invest in your own education because there is limited resources. You noted, Cosmos, that YouTube is one of the best resources, free of charge, to learn just about anything that you would want to learn about leadership or financial management or social entrepreneurship. And I also believe that there are a lot of resources that help you with self-paced learning, executive coaching, impactful small group experiences, mentoring relationships, influential networking. There are so many opportunities right now that provide leaders with valuable insight and tools and resources that maybe a generation ago would have cost a lot of money or would have been exclusively reserved for the elite. But now, because of platforms like YouTube, everyone has access to extraordinary learning. And I think that you have to find the people around you that are going to support you and embrace your passion and help you positively impact the issues that are most important to you by helping you accelerate your success. And that could be self-directed learning, that could be impactful group experiences, that could be expert-led coaching or mentorship. But there are now more people that are involved in bringing up the next generation than ever.
So, Linda, this is one question that I wanted to ask you of all people, right? Because this is a very, because there's two modes of thought over here. Like, let's say I'm a Gen Z or a millennial person, and I want, and let's say I'm into making sure that the environment, like, I want to tackle global warming or global change, for example, right? And I'm like right now working a job and I'm listening to this podcast and I'm inspired and I want to take action. But now there's two forms of action. You can either go and do government lobbying, or you can take the political route, or you can become a social impact entrepreneur, and you can take matters into your own hands, start your own company, make it profitable. But I don't know. I'm confused about the direction because I've been taught, my mindset for so long has been the only way to make changes to the government versus there's a new mode of thing, which is using your entrepreneurial spirit to do so. So what are your thoughts on how should a person listening to this, let's say they're doing a job, they're millennials, they want to take the step towards making a social impact. How would they go about doing that?
Yeah, so there's so many different ways. One could be the way that you invest your time and money. So if you invest your dollars in only those businesses that share your values, that share your commitment to, say, climate change or regenerating our land, and you are only going to invest in those businesses that share that value and share those principles, that's one way you can advance your vision and mission. You can also advance your mission and vision by simply volunteering. So you can volunteer for those businesses, those initiatives, those groups and services and products that help advance the issue of climate change or regeneration of the land or whatever it is that really you feel personally tied to. So you can volunteer your time. And by doing that, by volunteering with groups and organizations that are deeply embedded in the kind of business that really resonates with you, you're going to learn along the way about how that business is run, about how that operation is running, and you'll be able to take tips and insights from that to apply to a business should you want to open up a business. If you wanted to open up a business committed to advancing a particular cause, then by all means do that. There are literally millions and millions and millions of young people around the world that are beginning businesses every single day connected to a social cause. And that business initially may be just a side hustle. It may be something they do on weekends and evenings. It may be something they do in their spare time. But over the ensuing weeks and months, they may find that that business that was a bit of a side hustle is actually generating the kind of endorsement and support and revenue that allows them to step into that business full time. And I will also tell you that when you think about businesses, small businesses entrepreneurship is the driving force of every single economy around the world. And in fact, I really believe that women-led entrepreneurship can create tremendous positive social change, making women financially empowered and independent. And according to the US Census, women entrepreneurs, get this, run 42% of all American small businesses. That's nearly 13 million. And they employ 9.4 million people. And they generate nearly $2 trillion in revenue. Now, many of these entrepreneurial businesses are side hustles. They're not full-time jobs. And in fact, women started 1,800 net new businesses every single day last year. 64% of these are women-owned businesses were started by women of color. And get this, Latina women-owned businesses grew more than 87% last year. So there is definitely room for everyone. And if this is something that is really stirring within you, I would say there is a ton of opportunity for you to begin your own business. But if that's too daunting, you can definitely volunteer. You can definitely steward your financial investments in a way that supports the mission and vision that you feel connected to.
So Linda, like social impact entrepreneurship is a new concept, right? Most people think of doing a nonprofit, right? So in coming from your perspective, what would be the pros and cons of a person doing a nonprofit versus doing a business and making profits and then basically using that to do good?
Yeah, I'm not sure that I will understand all the nuances between a nonprofit and a social entrepreneur or social good sort of initiative. The one thing I would say is that nonprofits have a whole different set of rules and regulations, and they are managed very differently from a for-profit business. And if you wanted to move into a nonprofit venture, be sure that you are very clear about the costs, the rules, the regulations, and all the government oversight associated with a nonprofit. If you decide to develop a business that's not necessarily a nonprofit, but it is definitely focused on creating social good, advancing a particular mission, vision, if it's a purpose-driven, mission-driven business, whether it's a nonprofit or a for-profit, I would say that there is a ton of opportunity to do that. And as I mentioned earlier, sidepreneurs, those people that have an entrepreneurial venture is kind of a side hustle. Well, they've grown at a rate that's nearly twice as fast as the overall growth in entrepreneurship. And much of that growth comes from minority women, where sidepreneurship is two times higher. It's 65% compared to 32%. So even if this is something you did as a part-time initiative, I feel like the opportunities are extraordinary to develop a for-profit business that's mission-driven, that is purpose-bound. And I think that even if you're a woman-owned business or you're a minority-owned business, there are a ton of opportunities to create additional income, to be able to impact and advance the initiative that you feel called to actually impact. And now we're seeing more and more women-owned businesses, that is female investors, and perhaps even more important, brands are now supporting them in droves. So if you're a woman-owned business, if you're a minority-owned business, if you are beginning a side hustle, you're a part-time entrepreneur, but connected to social good, I will tell you that there are more and more businesses that are lifting up those small enterprises, that are investing in those small enterprises. And that progress should be recognized and celebrated. I believe that there are more and more businesses that are beginning to invest in social entrepreneurs.
No, I mean, there's been a lot of change, a lot of positive change in the last like few decades, right? Like the 20th century and the 21st century, there's been this period of human history for like thousands of years where things had been relatively stagnant, and suddenly in the last century and this one, it's just exploded in like an upward momentum, almost like a rocket. And there's just so much things going on. And then when people look at the internet, there's just an information overload of like so many resources out there for self-improvement. But it's just a matter of how do you focus on this, on which resources and which information will actually help you get to what you want? Because in today's generation, we're all facing like an information overload because there's just so much stuff out there. But it's about where to look. Who do you even listen? Because like there's a lot of people, they're saying a lot of different things. Many people say like are talking about information that they don't know what they're talking about. There's a lot of fake news as well. And so like I think that's something that we have to be aware of, is which one is actually real and will actually help you like to where you want to be, you know?
That's so smart. You're right. And I will say that there are resources too. Beyond the plethora of information that you have access to, you do have to be, I think, a savvy and discerning consumer of that information to understand what is fake news and what is a credible source, what is a credible resource of information. But I would also say there are incredible resources that are available to you as well. The federal government gives away millions of dollars in grants every single year to minority-owned businesses, women-owned businesses, veterans-owned businesses. For instance, the Small Business Administration in the United States has specific loan programs for women-owned businesses, minority-owned, veteran-owned. And while the SBA offers women's business ownership assistance grants, some business owners might also qualify for grants from the U.S. Department of Commerce's Minority Business Development Agency. And there are private grant programs that give away millions of dollars every single year to small businesses, often with very specific criteria. Now, some of these grants are aimed specifically at businesses owned and operated by women, but others are very industry focused. So they may say, if you're connected to climate change, or if you're trying to impact education for girls and women, or you care about clean air, clean water, these grants are specifically earmarked for those businesses. So some of the more well-known business grants include the Open Meadow Foundation, the Amber Grant, and then there are angel investment firms that specifically invest in businesses that are creating social good, businesses that are really social entrepreneurships. And some of the most well-known include Golden Seeds and Valor Ventures and Pipeline Angels, Funding Sage. So there are an incredible amount of resources that are also available to you. And with the rise of fintech startups, oh my gosh, there are so many new funding sources like peer-to-peer lending sites. So if capital is your concern or the ability to generate revenue is your concern, what I would say is tap into some of these resources that are available to you and where those dollars, those millions of dollars are earmarked specifically for people just like you.
No, Linda, that is amazing. Like there's so many resources out there. But one question I would have for the sake of the audience is how would you go about like talking to an investor, like talking about getting a grant or talking to an investor? Like what kind of business plan are they looking for? Because when it comes to social impact, like, yeah, the cause and vision is important, but ultimately we know the investors and like the gut, like, and they look for a profit. And then when it comes to a grant, there's also like a different process of getting that. So would you have any advice for how they would go about creating that plan?
Yes. In fact, in Leadership Global, one of our most exciting initiatives that we'll be launching very shortly is almost an investor pitch fest, where we are going to bring women who have an entrepreneurial vision and mission together with funders, people who are active investors. And we want to help the women who are interested in some sort of social impact entrepreneurial venture. We're going to help them define their vision. We're going to help them explain their leadership within that particular area. And then we're going to expand their influence so that they can create a lasting legacy by tapping into the investment dollars that they need to grow and scale their venture. And what I would say is, you know, absolutely there are opportunities to tap into those dollars. But when you stand on that stage and you are explaining who you are and what your impact is, I would say, number one, be clear about your vision. Be absolutely unapologetic and incredibly firm about the level of impact that you're going to create, what that vision is. Second, you have to convince the investors of your leadership in this area. So you have to explain who is coming along with you, who your other investors are, what your staff looks like, who your partners are, what your advisory board is, how that's made up. So you have to explain that there are people who have already invested their time, their advice, their guidance, or their dollars in that vision. And you have to grow that community of leaders around you to be able to, I guess, qualify your credentials. So when you are on that stage in front of the investors, you're going to have to explain how you are growing your leadership within that particular area of advancement and all the people that support you along the way. And then you have to give a trajectory of how you expect to expand your influence, what success looks like for you over the next 5 years. This includes not just the impact you're going to make with your idea, your mission, your vision, your purpose, but also it includes how you are going to grow your organization. So this is an organizational plan. This is a financial plan. This is about taking the dollars that they are going to grant you and being a good steward of the investment that you're going to receive. It's about clearly delineating how you are going to expand your influence by allocating the dollars that you're receiving in a smart, judicious way that will help you create a lasting legacy.
Linda, everything that you've said so far is just so intriguing, and it's so like this has to be done because this is the future of not just America and the world, but speaking on like a national platform, right? A lot of people have a vision of the American dream, especially the millennials and like the Gen Z, and they have an understanding of what it means to them. So from your perspective, how can social impact entrepreneurship fit into the American dream of financial freedom and them getting what they want in their life?
Oh, the two are inextricably linked. I feel like the next wave of millionaires, billionaires that we see in the world will be those people who had an extraordinary vision that other people got excited about. They latched onto that vision and they supported the advancement of that mission and vision. So when you can create a movement, a real movement, then you'll see that obstacles are moved out of the way, roadblocks are removed, opportunities open up, because the more electrifying your vision is, your mission, your purpose, the more you will find that others will support it. Others will come along beside you and say, how can I be involved? What can I do to help you? How can I support you? And it's that kind of momentum, it's that kind of movement that creates empires. So I got to tell you, in spite of all the obstacles facing entrepreneurs and specifically social entrepreneurs, there has never been a better time in US history to be a social impact entrepreneur. The number of firms that are connected to social impact, social good initiatives has grown by 68% since 2007, much higher than the national average of 47% for entrepreneurial ventures. And why? Because people become excited about doing something bigger than they are. They want to leave the world in a better position than they found it. They want to be connected to something that is meaningful and purposeful. Everyone yearns for that. They want their life to be meaningful. They want to leave an impact. And the best way to do that is to create a clear vision, create a clear mission, invite others along with you. And out of that, you will see revenue flow.
So Linda, that is actually truly inspiring. And one of the questions that I wanted to ask on with the current election cycle and the polarity that is happening, especially in the media, as a millennial and a Gen Z person, if I wanted to make an individual, like if I wanted to do something on an individual level through entrepreneurship and everything, like what should be my mindset in today's climate? And like, should I have that optimistic attitude for the future and America's future altogether?
I think you absolutely have lots of reasons to be optimistic. I think that globally, we are entering into a phenomenal decade where information flows quicker than ever before. Talent can be resourced all around the world. There is access to resources and dollars and investment faster now than ever before. And I think if you can embrace your passion, you can really clarify the impact you want to create. And you are dedicated to positively impacting the lives of this generation and the ones to follow us. You will find that your ability to accelerate your success is nearly unlimited, that the world has sped up incredibly, and that the barriers that once may have held us back a generation ago have all disappeared. Globally, we are more connected than ever before. In terms of commerce, we are more interdependent than we have ever been as a race. And in terms of the recognition of opportunity to create impact, the opportunity to create real impact globally has never been more needed and never been more embraced by government, by nonprofits, by for-profits, by think tanks, by even celebrity. You find that everyone is embracing the idea that they want their life to be something more than cashing their first $1 million check. They want their life to be connected to something that will be long-lasting, that will create sustainable transformation. You find celebrities doing this, and you find, street sweepers doing this because everyone recognizes the urgency that our planet is facing, but they also recognize the opportunity in a global system. And certainly now, a lot of the barriers that we may have faced a generation or two ago in terms of certain communities being closed off, certain borders being closed, certain information not being accessible, certain investment dollars not being provided to all people equally. All of those obstacles, all of those roadblocks are falling aside.
Linda, I would like to also add that for people li listening to this, that you have to have a clear idea and vision of what you want out of your life. And then from there, because like in today's world, everybody's trying to get you to do what they want to do, but it's about what will make you happy, right? And there's so much noise out there. Like you have to be focused, and you have to always know what you want, and you have to know who are the people and what are the resources that will help you get to that level. And for that, having a vision, a solid vision of your life, is very important. But most people like they don't actually go about doing a vision plan, or like a plan of like a 1 year or 6 month or 2 year kind of thing. What is the process? I'm here, I want to get to this point. So I wanted to stress that that is also pretty important, not only at an individual level, but also on a national level.
Absolutely, Cosmos. Such a good point. And I would also note that you have to be purposeful and intentional about the people you surround yourself with. It is so important that you meet inspirational leaders, that you create lifelong friendships with people who will invest in your vision, that you are surrounded with people who will be deeply committed to your success. And I would say if you purposefully and intentionally seek out those relationships, you're going to develop and discover partners, employees, mentors that can take you to that next level. But you have to be intentional about who you surround yourself with.
No, totally, Linda. And yeah, that is one of the things that's really important, because you have to control the information that comes into your mind, because a lot of times negativity can just seep in. And as entrepreneur's mindset is like half the battle, more than half actually. And what you feed your mind ultimately decides if you're going to be successful or not. But on another question I wanted to ask regarding leadership global, I know you started this, but what is the premise of how you got about to starting this company?
So I really believe, as I said, that the key to success is to create and support personal and professional breakthroughs in your own life and in the lives of those around you. And so we are absolutely dedicated to guiding women to achieve greater leverage, greater freedom in their careers and their businesses. We provide a global community of world-class women thought leaders, experts, entrepreneurs, business owners and founders that are brought together to collaborate and to facilitate excellent outcomes for each other. So I believe that once you find a community like we have created in Leadership Global, you have the opportunity to be inspired and motivated by other leaders who will cheer you on, who will offer counsel to you, who will support you to greater and greater levels of success and impact. And so, in my mind, that really is the key to long-lasting success, connected with this idea of giving back. The fulfilling feeling of giving back and contributing to others is absolutely unparalleled. True meaning and true purpose is about how you're able to better the lives of the people around you, your loved ones, the people in your community, the people in your business, the lives of people somewhere else in the world. Meaning never comes from what you get, it comes from what you give. And so find ways to give back and make an impact in the world, and you will find that your life becomes richly rewarded.
Linda, for the women that are listening to us right now, that want to be entrepreneurs, that are already entrepreneurs, I would want them to definitely check out Leadership Global and see what it's all about, because this is actually a very important resource that can help them in so many ways. And Linda, are there any other projects that you're doing right now that you want the audience to get a glimpse into?
Oh, thank you for asking. Yeah, the one big project that we have coming up, which I'm so excited about, is something that I referenced earlier. It's our pitch fest, where we are going to match up entrepreneurs who are ready for their Series A or Series B funding together with investors who are looking for that incredible unicorn, that new idea that will unlock incredible futures for everyone around the globe. So we are creating relationships between those that are interested in supporting, especially social entrepreneurship ventures, together with those that are really trying to positively impact the world through their social engagement, through their businesses, their ventures, their organizations. They're trying to create sustainable transformation around the globe. And by matching them up, pairing them up, and helping entrepreneurs present their idea, present their organization, their business in a really compelling way, we hopefully will create an entire new generation of entrepreneurs that have the capital necessary to grow and scale their business.
That is amazing, Linda. And Linda, how can our audience get to connect with you and get to know more of you and your work and everything that you do?
I love that, Fred. Thank you so much for asking, Cosmos. What I would invite you to do is to simply email me. It's linda@leadershipglobal.com or connect with me on LinkedIn. I'm Linda Fisk, the chairwoman of leadershipglobal.com. Or you're welcome to come to our website, leadershipglobal.com, and simply drop me a note. Any of those ways, I would be happy to connect with anyone who might be listening into the podcast and anxious to connect to an extraordinary global community of women that are deeply invested in each other's success.
Linda, thank you so much for that. And I really appreciate that you took the time to come into this podcast and share your wisdom. Because, yes, we have a new generation and social impact and entrepreneurship are intertwined. And we need more of this in the world, because that's how positive impact can actually be created on a global level, not just a national level. And I do hope that you take the time to come back onto the show at a later time.
I would love that, Cosmos. Thank you so much for offering that.
And I want to conclude this episode by letting my fellow extraordinary Americans know that, hey, look, there's an extraordinary within each and every one of us, and it's our duty to awaken it and unleash it. Until next time, bye for now.
Hey, everyone. Thank you for watching Extraordinary America. If you like what you see, please do subscribe to our podcast and share it with others. Remember that the best investment that you can make in your lifetime is in your own financial education, for it is knowledge that truly sets us free. Also remember that inflation is diluting your purchasing power, which in turn increases financial bondage. The practical thing to do is to protect the loss of your purchasing power and invest in precious metals or the right cryptocurrencies. Lastly, never forget that you are an extraordinary American. We'll see you in the next episode. Bye for now.